The next question is, what sort of manager do Liverpool need, and how do they avoid the pain that I think both, let's say, Manchester United after Sir Alex Ferguson, and Arsenal after Arsene Wenger, is it inevitable you're going to have a painful reorganisation of the club when the new man comes in?
Well, not to the same level as Manchester United and Arsenal, because what Wenger and Ferguson created was a situation where they were the boss of everything. My understanding is that everything went through them.
Yeah.
And Liverpool have spent a lot of time now over the years building up a structure behind Klopp, working in conjunction with Klopp and his team in terms of, so for example, the recruitment. You know, the recruitment is set up away from him, if you like, even though it works with him. But the structure at the club's really good. The academy's running beautifully. There's a lot of positive things. I mean, I think there's not as much changing and tweaking to do. Yeah, of course, if all his staff leave, then of course there's some really important positions to be filled. But the overall structure of the club, the financial position they're in, the ownership, everything about it is settled. So I don't think it's as big in that respect, Darren. I don't know what you think about that.
Before I just come in, you know, if you're a player, because the Virgil van Dijk comments were interesting, and I just was thinking from a player's perspective, is Virgil, with that short amount of time left on his contract, is he thinking to himself, all the things that you just mentioned there about the stability, that could be shaken once Pep Linders and the rest of Peter Kravitz and
Virgil van Dijk won't care about any of the others but Klopp.
Right. So it won't matter. And the reason I ask that is that I remember when Sir Alex left, David Gill went, so straight away that stability that they had working hand in glove, that's gone. Rennie Meulensteen left. Again, another very popular figure behind the scenes at Carrington and obviously within the coaching staff. And other people left that the players had, you know, a relationship in some way, shape or form. Does that not bother you as a player when a manager who is as loved as Klopp goes?
I think it unsettles players who have a good relationship with him, because you're always a little bit concerned if you're not a superstar and the number one, two or three, you know, if you're not Mo Salah or Virgil van Dijk, you're thinking, how's that going to affect me? Does he see me like Klopp sees me?
Yeah.
So that would be an initial concern. But most of the players are very talented and very sought after if they became available. So that wouldn't be too much indecision, no, wrong word, there wouldn't be too much concern from a lot of the players. Now, in terms of people like Van Dijk and Salah, I wouldn't throw Trent into that because he's a Liverpool lad, he'll be staying. But Virgil and Mo Salah at a certain age, I think they've both got 18 months left, I think that's right. There is a situation there where you could, they could use it as a way out to try something new. They could. Yeah, that's possible.
Because
Virgil's words...
From our point of view as journalists, once Virgil says what he has said, that gives rise to a conversation about the future.
In some ways, I actually admire his honesty.
Yeah.
Because it's very honest, and it's a bit too honest. And I'm not... The timing's not very good on it. I'd have kept Stom for a while, just got on with the job. Because you've had the bombshell of Klopp, and now, really, what Van Dijk's saying, depending on what the club do, will depend on what I do. That's ultimately what he said, isn't it?
Yeah, no.
He's not saying I'm going, but he's not saying I'm here no matter what.
Liverpool fans won't thank me for saying this, but there's also a part of in a world, and they've only got to look across Stanley Park to see it, where suddenly FFP has teeth that you could make an argument if you've got monstrous bids for great players like Van Dijk and even Mo Salah, to go to, say, Saudi Arabia, that, you know, in the new world we're currently inhabiting, and who knows how that world will change when the Premier League finally get around to doing something or nothing, whatever they're going to do, about Manchester City, that they might say, well, look, hanging on to players in their 30s on giant wages is no longer feasible. We need to get these fees in and get their replacements long-term and current-term on the books. But let's go back to the managers, because, you know, I'm like with Harry Kane. Fans want to hang on to these players forever and ever, amen. But the club, they have business to do as well as just running, you know, the emotional side of the teams. What kind of a manager do you think, Darren, they'll be looking for? Because in Klopp, there was an interesting choice, wasn't it? Because they went for somebody who had been successful without being monstrously successful, but in many ways was a tailor-made fit. Dortmund were in the shadow of Bayern, Liverpool were in the shadow of Manchester United, a post-industrial city, and he had made them real challengers and indeed had won the title. What kind of, or will they look for somebody perhaps younger, more up and coming? Because now the fashion is tends to be for managers with brand new ideas coming into clubs.
Well, I do feel that we are in the age of the manager. And I think if you look at Tottenham as an example, and I never thought I'd be using Tottenham as an example for what Liverpool are doing, but Ange Postecoglou.
Thank you, Darren. You can come again next week, despite your treachery last time.
You've got some better on next week.
I can't afford the wage cut. I think as far as Spurs are concerned, Ange Postecoglou goes into a situation where they've lost the best striker in Europe, and he reconfigures that team into buying into his ideas and his ethics and his vision, and also the level of discipline as well. He has, and he changes the culture at a club that had been treading water. And that's what Klopp did at Liverpool. And I think all the most successful clubs in this country all have managers in charge of the football club who set a standard and have an ethos about the way that you conduct yourself as a player and the level of performance and the consistency that you have to be able to produce. And I think with Liverpool, you go an extra stage further, because I think that Klopp is an extrovert. I think he's plugged into the fans, the fan base. I've seen other managers go there and with a humility that the fans didn't really take to. I remember the much respected Roy Hodgson going to Liverpool and being respectful of other teams and their dangers and their strengths and whatever. And the fans say, hang on a minute, we're Liverpool.
Yeah, you can't
don't
do
be
it.
Talking like that about us. We're Liverpool. And
the examples, just to, I don't know what Danny will tell, it's the M62 that joins Liverpool to Manchester.
Yeah.
Erik ten Hag, who is a perfectly good technical manager, we've seen this in what he's done in Holland, but one thing he hasn't done, he just hasn't convinced the Manchester United fans, never mind the players, he hasn't convinced the Manchester United fans that he understands exactly where they all are.
Exactly.
There's a huge part of the modern game.
Listen, I remember that in a moment, and Dan, you can elaborate on this, but I remember when Jordan Henderson was subbed in a game. And he had a go at Klopp on the touchline, and Klopp properly flexed his muscles in that moment, and not just to Henderson, but by extension to the rest of the dressing room, and also to the fan base as well. And there are moments in any manager's tenure where you have to basically say, you know, you, as Ferguson always said, you know, you lose a dressing room and you're dead. Anyone takes you on and looks as though they're going to have any level of success, that's you, that's got to be them dead, otherwise that's you dead. And that's never been the case with Klopp.
He's done that brilliantly, yeah, but there's no manager going to come through the door, there's no candidate out there, there's no manager who's going to come through the door who ticks all the boxes.
No, this is
a compromise appointment because of what's just gone. Now, Klopp has certain critics in out there, you know, in terms of some of his behaviour and the overzealous celebrating and some of the stuff with the officials, all that. But no manager is going to come into the equation on this topic and tick all the boxes. So you have to just tick as many as you can.
Yeah.
And the reason I've said Alonso all along really is obviously he gets the fans and the club, and that's a start. He plays good football. Leverkusen play good football. Yeah, it's a different style, three at the back and a bit more possession based, but it's quite dynamic. And he can be more dynamic with better players. He's got wonderful appeal, I would imagine, to signing players. I mean, who wouldn't want to play for someone like Alonso? He's charismatic. He's different than Klopp in terms of he's a bit more calmer. He seems that way. Anyway, that might evolve as time goes by and the pressure builds.
Premier League will fix that for him.
Yeah,
don't worry.
Exactly. he's worked under Guardiola. He's worked under Ancelotti. He's worked under some unbelievable managers. So there's so many. And he's a good coach, apparently. Yes, he's a coach.
Yeah.
Now, other people don't necessarily do the coaching. So there's a lot of boxes ticked. But there's no candidate anybody's giving me or talking about to me that you would say you could go in there and be 100% confident or even 90% confident that they're going to be able to stay at that level and keep Liverpool at that level because of what Klopp has done.
On AM, on DAB, via the TalkSport app and on your smart speaker. TalkSport.